Hello, everyone. Welcome to another episode by Engineering Today. And we're back again with your most favorite topic, Starship. Elon Musk's private space company, SpaceX, is moving ahead of its time to develop a next-generation Starship that will eventually take humans to Mars. SpaceX's SN8 Starship prototype is currently taking its time for the second static fire test, and after that, it will attempt a three-raptor flight test later this month. As per that, Musk put a light on the primary goals of SN8's flight test. According to information provided by SpaceX officials, Starship's SN8's second static fire test includes cryogenic proof testing of the nose cone's LOX header tank, followed by a set of ever-evolving static fire tests, which will begin with one, then two engines. Lastly, SN8 will conduct a three-raptor static fire test. For the second static fire test, Raptor SN36 will be used instead of SN39. SN8 Starship is aiming to reach an altitude of 50,000 feet by using the power of three Raptor engines and its brand new aerodynamic flaps. The header tank system is behind the big win of engine relight, and it will supply the Raptors. The aerodynamic surfaces will play a vital role during SN8's launch and landing back to the ground. If the launch goes successfully, it will be a major data point for SpaceX. As per a Twitter reply, Musk wrote, "Stable, controlled descent with body flaps would be great. Transferring propellant feed from main to header tanks and relight would be a major win." To improve the ground testing, SN8 will ignite its first Raptor during the flip, and then it will conduct a two-engine landing burn. Understanding exactly how the body flaps control pitch, yaw, and roll during descent, such that the ship is positioned well to relight, flip, and land, would be a big win, Musk stated. But a RUD right-off launch pad is also possible. Fortunately, SN9 is almost ready. Regarding the Starship flight test, Musk also provided an unfortunate scenario where SN8 is failing after leaving the launch pad. But the failure point of this text is mostly expected to be during an attempt to return to the pad. If the return trip doesn't go according to plan, Musk also has an alternative, which is to drop SN8 into the sea. Although, if it fails right at the end, some landing pad repair will be needed to fill in the crater. While SN8 is getting ready for a second static fire test, SpaceX is also making progress on its SN9 Starship prototype. A footage has been captured showing SN9 moving to the high bay for aerosurface installation. Thus, it's the first time that SpaceX's future Starship took shelter in the new facility for some pre-flight adjustments. After moving SN8 to high bay, the company's mid-bay facility is now stacking Starship SN10. As Musk previously stated on Twitter, SN9 will have some minor refinements as compared to SN8. It's been found that SN9 is the first prototype to have a structure entirely made from 304L steel, whereas some of SN8's parts are still made of 301 alloy. Constructors are currently working on high bay's gantry crane, and once it's finished, the crane will start stacking up the Super Heavy booster. After stacking up SN10 in the mid-bay facility, the company will move on to the next one in the Starship lineup, SN11. Some other vehicle parts are also located on site, which could be for SN12. This year, the International Space Station completed its 20 years. It all started when a NASA astronaut, Bill Shepard, along with two Russian cosmonauts, Sergei Krikalev and Yuri Gudzenko, aboard a Soyuz spacecraft, traveled into orbit. That was the first crewed flight, Expedition 1, to the space station that took place on the 31st of October in the year 2000. The spacecraft then docked with the International Space Station, and since then, astronauts have made a constant presence on the orbiting laboratory. The very first moment on the space station was not that easy for the astronauts. Shepard, as the first ISS commander, wanted to give a nickname Alpha to the station. The first expedition on the space station requests permission to take the radio call sign Alpha, Shepard stated over the public loop. But at the time, Russian space officials wanted to name the station Beta, as their earlier Mir space station had earned the honor to have the nickname Alpha. The most recent launch to the space station, known as Expedition 64, took place in October 2020. Kate Rubens, a NASA astronaut from Expedition 64, said, I think the International Space Station is one of the most incredible engineering achievements in human history. She also said, it's quite a marvel to see such a giant machine that was built entirely by humans and flown off the surface of Earth still persists in space 20 years later. NASA officials tweeted, on November 2, 2000, Expedition 1 arrived at the space station. Our orbiting laboratory has been continuously inhabited ever since. Over 240 humans and 19 countries have visited, carrying out over 3,000 ISS research investigations. The space station is quite unique as based on its features, and it's one of the largest spacecraft in orbit. Astronauts on board the station perform various experiments. However, some are still concerned about the retirement of the space station before there's a replacement. According to NASA Administrator Jim Bridenstine, this is critically important. He said, it's something that never gets funded. Maintaining the space station hasn't been so easy. NASA spent around $150 billion to assemble and maintain the station since 1990, when the process of assembling the space station first started. It's found that with all the activities regarding to ISS, which involves sending astronauts to the station, conducting research or several outreach events, it's reached over 108 countries. We've been able to stay out of politics and work on physics-based philosophy. It's hard and it's challenging work with different cultures and time changes, but it sets a good example for the rest of the world, said Joe Montalbano, NASA's program manager for ISS. Now, what about the future of the space station? 2 years ago, a discussion regarding the future of the space station was started by the Trump administration, where they talked about ending the direct support to the space station in 2025. As for that, the White House declared that NASA should transition to commercial provision of low Earth orbit capabilities, although that notion immediately met pushback from Congress members, especially from Texas and Florida, as it would be benefited by space station-related jobs. Bridenstine talked about a day when the ISS is going to end. He said, we really love the ISS, but we do have to think about the fact that 20 years is a long time. We have to be able to make the investments today so we don't have a gap in low Earth orbit. According to Montalbano, the ISS program could support flying the station to 2030. Well, today the ISS is agreed to fly through 2024. From an engineering standpoint, we can go further than that, Montalbano stated. We've looked through 2028 and there's no issue. There's nothing magical about that, and I feel from an engineering standpoint we can go past 2028. In the case of the commercial market, a problem was found with the commercialization of low Earth orbit and private space stations. Jeff Manber, who's co-founder of NanoRacks, an in-space services company, stated, I'm growing increasingly concerned about NASA's plans to ensure we do not have a space station gap. I know there's a strong push to have the station budgeted through 2030, and that's lovely. However, the station is a complex technology wonder that's 20 years old, and the hardware is even older. We need to start planning now and take advantage of American commercial capabilities. Although NASA has two separate tricks up its sleeves to stimulate commercial space station development, one is to award a commercial company with a contract to build modules for the space station. The company could use station power, communication service, and some other resources while developing the module. Another way to stimulate commercial space station development is organizing a free flyer concept, though NASA later put it on hold. For now, NASA decided to go with the first way. Thus, in January 2020, the agency gave a $140 million contract to a startup company, Axiom Space, which is co-founded by a former ISS program manager, Michael Suffredini. Under the contract, Axiom would develop a module for ISS that is scheduled to launch in 4 years from now. Commercial astronauts are important early on, but the manufacturing piece will outpace it vastly in the future, according to Matt Ondler, Chief Technology Officer for Axiom. Now, as a conclusion, ISS has played an important role for the step-by-step development of the space industry in these 20 years. Robert Perlman, the co-author of Space Stations, The Art, Science, and Reality of Working in Space, said ISS stands after the Apollo mission. According to Perlman, in some ways, the International Space Station has represented a greater engineering feat than the Apollo moon landings or any previous effort in space. He added, Building and operating the space station over the past 20 years has required an unprecedented level of international collaboration, even at times when the partner nations were at odds with each other over unrelated earthly matters. In addition, designing critical systems to not just last but perform reliably for two decades has presented a challenge that's perhaps unique to the ISS experience. With a remarkable history, the International Space Station has built a legacy for the next generation space explorers. Perlman said, "Due to the advent of social media and other technologies, the ISS has also offered the public an unmatched opportunity to participate in active space missions, both virtually and for the select few as spaceflight participants. For the first time in history, the public was not limited to only watching what was happening, but now interacting with the crew and the science being conducted on board on a regular occurrence. This may ultimately be the space station's greatest contribution for the future of space exploration." Thanks for watching. Please subscribe for more videos like this. Hit the like button if you find the video interesting, and kindly provide your valuable feedback in the comment section. This will help us to improve.